Sunshine vitamin. Of course you know what I am talking about. It's vitamin D. But how does it affect our body? Can my skin produce vitamin D while I am looking at the window? Is there any link between vitamin D and COVID-19? My name is Dr. Zarifa Ramanova. Today I will clarify all these points about vitamin D. Vitamin D is both a nutrient we eat and a hormone our bodies make. It is a fat-soluble vitamin that helps our body absorb and retain calcium and phosphorus. Both processes are critical for bone growth and bone renewal. Without sufficient vitamin D, bones can become thin, brittle or misshapen. Vitamin D deficiency prevents rickets in children and osteomalacia in adults. Vitamin D has other roles in the body, including modulation of cell growth, neuromuscular, immune function, and reduction of inflammation. The role of vitamin D in disease prevention is a popular area of research. But clear answers about the benefit of taking vitamin D supplements are not conclusive. Researchers found that higher intakes of vitamin D supplements, about 500 to 800 international units per day, reduced hip and non-spine fractures by about 20%, while lower intakes failed to offer any fracture prevention benefit. This conclusion was made in the meta-analysis of 12 randomized controlled trials, which included more than 42,000 people 65 years of age and older. Falls is a common problem that leads to substantial disability and death in older people. Vitamin D may also help increase muscle strength, which in turn helps to prevent falls. A combined analysis of multiple studies found that taking 700 to 1000 international units of vitamin D per day lowered the risk of falls by 90%, but taking less amount didn't offer any such protection. Animal and laboratory studies have found that vitamin D can inhibit the development of tumors and slow down the growth of existing tumors, including those from the breast, ovary, colon, prostate, and brain. In humans, epidemiological studies showed that higher serum levels of vitamin D are associated with low rates of colon, pancreatic, prostate, and other cancers. Although vitamin D doesn't seem to be a major factor in reducing cancer incidence, evidence suggests that having higher vitamin D status may improve cancer survival. The heart is basically a large muscle that has receptors for vitamin D. Immune and inflammatory processes play a role in cardiovascular diseases. They are regulated by vitamin D. The vitamin also helps to keep arteries flexible and relaxed, which in turn helps to control higher blood pressure. Let's take a look at the health professionals' follow-up study. Nearly 50,000 healthy men were followed for 10 years. People with the lowest serum levels of vitamin D had a significantly increased risk of strokes and any heart disease event compared with those with the highest level. However, another meta-analysis of 51 clinical trials did not demonstrate that vitamin D supplementation lowered the risk of heart attack, stroke, or deaths from cardiovascular diseases. Vitamin D deficiency may negatively affect the biochemical pathways that lead to development of type 2 diabetes, including impairment of beta cell function in the pancreas, insulin resistance, and inflammation. More than 83,000 women without diabetes at baseline were followed in the Nurses' Health study. This research took 20 years. The authors found that women with the highest intakes of vitamin D from supplements have shown a 13% lower risk of developing type 2 diabetes compared with women with the lowest intakes. The effect was even stronger when vitamin D was combined with calcium. there was a 33% lower risk of type 2 diabetes. Scientists explored two research paths of the impact of vitamin D on the immune system. The first path: does vitamin D deficiency contribute to the development of multiple sclerosis, type 1 diabetes, and other autoimmune diseases, where the body's immune system attacks its own organs and tissues? And the second path: could vitamin D supplements help us to fight infectious diseases such as tuberculosis and seasonal flu? The rate of multiple sclerosis is increasing in different countries with an unclear cause. The risk of multiple sclerosis is increased due to the following reasons: a person's genetic background plus environmental factors including inadequate vitamin D and ultraviolet B rays exposure. A prospective study of dietary intake of vitamin D found women with daily intake above 400 international units of vitamin D had a 40% lower risk of multiple sclerosis. Other prospective studies in adults from Sweden and Finland have shown that lower risk of multiple sclerosis is associated with higher serum vitamin D levels. Early evidence suggests that vitamin D may play a role in type 1 diabetes. A 30-year study that followed more than 10,000 Finnish children had shown children who regularly received vitamin D supplements during infancy had a nearly 90% lower risk of developing type 1 diabetes than those who did not receive supplements. A prospective study among healthy young adults in the United States found that individuals with the highest vitamin D levels of serum had a 44% lower risk of developing type 1 diabetes in adulthood than those in the lowest levels. However, no randomized controlled trials on vitamin D and adult onset type 1 diabetes have been conducted. More research is needed in this area. The flu virus wreaks the most havoc in the winter, abating in the summer months. Several scientists published a paper suggesting that vitamin D may be the seasonal stimulus. Children who have vitamin D deficiency rickets are more likely to get respiratory infections, while children exposed to sunlight seem to have fewer respiratory infections. A randomized controlled trial included more than 300 Japanese school children. Half of them received 1,200 international units of vitamin D supplements. The other half received placebo pills. Researchers found that type A influenza rates in vitamin D group were about 40% lower than in the placebo group, and there was no significant difference in type B influenza rates. The active form of vitamin D tempers the damaging inflammatory response of white blood cells, while it also boosts immune cells' production of microbe-fighting proteins. Adults who have low vitamin D levels are more likely to report having had a cough, cold, or upper respiratory tract infection. According to Philippine scientists, vitamin D supplementation could possibly improve clinical outcomes of patients infected with COVID-19. The results of studies suggest that an increase in serum vitamin D level could either improve clinical outcomes or mitigate worse outcomes, while a decrease in serum vitamin D level could worsen clinical outcomes of COVID-19 patients. The United States and Hungarian researchers found that vitamin D supplementation can help reduce hospital-associated infections. Concentrations of at least 40 to 50 nanograms per milliliter are indicated in the basis of observational studies. During the COVID-19 epidemic, people in the hospital, including patients and staff, should take vitamin D supplements to raise 25-hydroxy vitamin D concentrations as an important step in preventing infections and spread. Trials on that hypothesis would be worth conducting. Several case-control studies suggest that people diagnosed with tuberculosis have lower vitamin D levels than healthy people of similar age and other characteristics. Such studies do not follow individuals over time, so they cannot tell us whether vitamin D deficiency leads to the increased tuberculosis risk or whether taking vitamin D supplements would prevent tuberculosis. Again, more research is needed. A promising report found in the Archives of Internal Medicine. The analysis looked at the findings from 18 randomized controlled trials with nearly 60,000 participants. Most of them took between 400 and 800 international units of vitamin D per day for about 5 years. The report suggests that taking modest levels of vitamin D supplements was associated with 7% reduction in mortality from any cause. This rate is statistically significant. Keep in mind that this analysis has several limitations. We need more research before any broad claims can be made about vitamin D and mortality.